The main point of this lesson is that you are going to be able to identify the four main reasons that the Nazis led to power. So it's not that just Germany lost the war and all of a sudden the Nazis came to power. It took a decade for this to happen. It's not like Hitler just automatically became the leader. There are many different factors that had to happen to make this possible. Okay, so you're going to get a series of photos. And for now, we're just going to do this individually. You don't really know much about the photos. There's no information, there's no words, there's no dates. And this is just real quick. You are going to look at all three photos. And this paper, the second paper that I'm handing out, we'll use for the rest of the day today. So what I would like you to do for the three photos is first tell me what is happening, just based off of what you see. And then the second thing is to tell me, after you figured out what is happening in the photos, to maybe guess and explain how these things could have happened. Okay, so we're going to take 5 minutes to do this individually and then come back together. And in the boxes, you can just jot down quick things that we are going to discuss as a class after. Okay. I'm going to put one of the photos up here because it's a little bit harder to see. Thank you. see lots of stuff written down. Just tell me what you see. We have people lining up. What kind of people? How do you know they're Jewish people? I hear their uniforms. I hear
stars.
I hear stars. Do you see stars?
Yeah.
Okay, so you see the N, and then around it here is the star. Okay, that's a perfect symbol. That would show you that they might be Jewish. What do you think the N stands for? Take a guess. Besides Nazi, it's not Nazi. They wouldn't label themselves like that. How could it identify them further? It stands for the Netherlands. It stands for where they're from. Okay, what else do we know about these people? You told me they were lined up. You told me that perhaps they were Jewish because of the symbol on their uniform. What else? They all have the same shaped head. Okay? Which could mean that they're what? You also told me something about what they're wearing. They're prisoners. Okay? So if we can assume that they're prisoners, and you know what topic we're talking about, where can we assume that they are? In some concentration camp. Okay, this happens to be a camp called Buchenwald. It's in Germany. It's one of the largest concentration camps that there was in Germany. Okay, there's one more thing that we're missing that you all can probably tell from this picture about these people. They're all men. Okay, they are men. Okay, let's take a look at the next one. All right. What do we see here? We see some clothes, okay. What else do we see? What type of people do we see?
The soldiers.
Why do you think they're soldiers? They're wearing some sort of uniform, okay. Do we know where they're from?
Mm-hmm.
No. Can we assume where they're from?
Yeah.
Where do you think they're from?
German.
Why? If you came closer and you looked at some of the other people in this photo, are they all soldiers?
No.
If you looked a little bit closer.
Yeah.
Tell me why this person here is different than these people here.
He doesn't have a helmet.
He doesn't have a helmet. Instead, what does he have on?
Bandana.
I heard it. A cap.
Oh.
So what could we assume about this person? That he's not a soldier because he's too
young.
Yeah. Perhaps it's a boy. Okay, well, we heard from somebody that they might be getting on this train. Does it look like it would be possible to do that? No. These are actually American soldiers. This is at a camp called Dachau, which is another concentration camp in Germany. On this train, there were 4,000 of these railroad cars. This is in April 1945. So this is right before the end of World War II, right before the surrender of Germany. This had 4,000 death cars. So he's showing these soldiers here. These are members of the Hitler Youth. which you would not have known because there's no identifying marks to show that, they're showing them the consequence of what just happened in the Holocaust. And these are trains of people. So they happen to also be dead. Okay, so this is the aftermath of the Holocaust. This is 1945. So let's look at the last picture. We have a lot of things going on here. I'm going to zoom in just a little bit. Tell me what you see. We have a crowd of people. Are they all the same type of person?
No.
Okay, how do you know? Okay, you see some people in uniform. So what can we assume about those people? Those are perhaps the prisoners. Ariana, you have a bunch of stuff written down about this one. Don't you? Tell me something. There's men and women, and it seems like they're all waiting for something. Why do you think that? That's an interesting... They're carrying what kind of stuff?
Belongings.
So look a little bit closer. What are they next to? You said they're next to a camp. How do you know that? Okay, you see it. Maybe, perhaps, it's a barbed wire fence. We don't know for sure. You see the background, which could, oh, you see this right here, which could be the barbed wire fence, which you might have seen in movies before. But what else are they next to? I heard it. The train tracks. Okay, so perhaps they're either waiting for the train, or perhaps they just got off the train. Okay, and actually, this is at Auschwitz. You can visit Auschwitz today. Does anybody want to tell me where Auschwitz is located? In what country?
Austria.
It's okay, you'll learn this later on next year. It's in Poland. You can go there today, and it's very well maintained. The Polish government and the German government both feel it's very important to make sure that this place here stays intact for people like us to go visit. They want us to be able to see what had happened here. And it's actually, what's interesting about Auschwitz here is part of it is built on a swamp. And what do you know about a swamp? Swamp is very wet ground. So it's starting to sink a little bit. And they're having some problems keeping this place intact for us to go visit. Anyway, what's happening in this picture is you have people who just arrived off the train. They were just deported to Auschwitz from wherever they were before. And these people here are prisoners at Auschwitz who are now in charge of moving these people along. And they're moving them along to two different lines. Perhaps some of you have seen this before in movies. Those two different lines will decide what? If you work, or if you end up going into the gas chamber at Auschwitz. Okay. So now, just very quickly then, after we've seen these three photos, and these are kind of the aftermath photos, these are the effects. Okay, I haven't shown you bodies, I haven't showed you some of the more graphic and horrific images that I could have, but how could this have happened? How could this whole entire society of civilized people let something like this happen? You don't have to answer now, but that's kind of the question of what we want in the back of our head. How in the world could this happen? Okay, we can talk about all the factors, which we are going to today, but does that still ultimately answer the question of why? Why did this happen? And how? How could we let it happen? Okay, what you have on your table, I already passed out. If you could flip it over, and if I gave it to the person on the end, pass it to your classmates. So this is really an assessment for me, so I can see that you have learned what you are supposed to learn. You might not have seen something like this before, so let me just explain how you fill this out. So I want you to consider this first line here, just one question. And if there's no right or wrong, I'm not going to give you a grade for getting it wrong. I just want to see where you're at now and then where you're at after we're done with this tomorrow. So if you read the first statement, Germany lost World War I. However, they achieved a successful democratic society despite their loss. Remember, a democratic society is where the people have the power, where the people choose the leaders and have a voice, kind of like what we have here. If you 100% agree with this statement and know that it's true, you will circle a 3. If you kind of believe that this statement is true, you'll circle a 2. Okay? Or maybe you don't agree with this, and you look at the opposite side. After Germany lost World War I, they had a difficult time electing leaders to properly run their nation. Maybe you believe this is 100% true instead of that one. So you'll circle a 3. Maybe you believe it's kind of true, you'll circle a 2. And then a 0 is like, I have no idea what I'm reading. I'm going to circle 0 because I just don't know. Okay? So you have 4 statements. Let's just take 5 minutes or so to fill that out before we begin. And also, please put your name on these. Nudama, I will take your paper. To what's going to take us probably the rest of the time today. And our goal is try to figure out if we can get what 4 factors led to the Nazis ultimately rising to power. And we're going to do that by looking at some more pictures. So you have folders here, but before you go through it, go ahead and flip over this paper with the pictures to the back. So, this is just for quick notes. Okay, you don't need to write an essay here, you don't need to write complete sentences. This is just to write down notes so then you can participate in our discussion. In your folders, you have 4 sets of pictures. We're all going to do A together. Then we'll talk about A, then we'll do B, and talk about B. So when you get A, you'll only pull out A, and you have 2 pictures for each set. You have A1 and A2. these two pictures somehow go together to make one reason or factor that the Nazis rose to power. Our goal is to try to figure out what that factor is based on the photo. Okay? So your main job is to discuss with your groups what's happening in the photo. Some of them I did give you a caption to kind of help you out a little bit more since you can't read German. I told you what was on the signs and perhaps where it was taking place. But your job is to really look at the photo and try to figure out what is happening. Okay? Does it look like a normal street? Are there children involved? What type of people are in the photo? Okay, this photo can tell us a whole lot of information without having any words behind it. And then you look at the next one, okay, which there are no people at all. And I did give you some of the translation and see how these two could perhaps relate. So we're not going to spend too much time per photo, so I'll give you about 5 minutes to discuss in your group for letter A. What you're going to keep in mind is, number one, what is happening? And number two, what could the possible meaning or main idea of these photos be when we combine them together? Questions? All right, so go ahead and take out document A and look at them as a group and start discussing what is happening. Okay, so 5 minutes for this one, maybe a little bit less.
Protesting what?
Exactly.
Okay, and why would they do that?
So we have a home.
Okay. So okay. So what? So it does say Jewish here, but if this were covered, would you know it was about Jewish people? How?
Yeah, I mean, is that what's going on?
You have that propaganda there. That's exactly right. So, what? Who are these people?
Oh,
do you know from where? It's in there.
I'm
All right, about one more minute. As a teacher or a mishmit or whoever your next history teacher is, we'll talk more about this stuff, okay? A lot of times the question is asked is why the Jewish people? Why did Hitler, why did the Nazis target the Jewish people? And there's a long, long history behind it, something that would take more than the time we have to explain. But when you're Germany and the Treaty of Versailles has been placed on you, you've been blamed for the war, you're in utter destruction, naturally you look for somebody to blame. what we do. We look for somebody else to blame. And in this case, it was the Jewish people. Let's blame them for this loss of the war. Okay, there's got to be reasons we can find to put all this blame on them. Okay, that's where a lot of the hatred is going to come from as well. Okay, let's go to the next one. All right, Ariana, what do we know about this slide? It's a quote from Adolf Hitler. To who? There's a specific group. It's on your slide. What youth?
The Hitler youth.
Okay, all German children at this time in Germany were required to go through the Hitler youth, where they were educated about what Nazism was, where they were educated about the ideals of what Hitler believed from a very, very young age. All their textbooks were thrown out, they were rewritten, and then they were told all sorts of, you could call it propaganda, about what the Nazis stood for. And in this case, what does the quote mean? Peace treaties, okay, the Treaty of Versailles, meant to establish peace, which demands people as scourge, so like a punishment to meet, often plays the first drum roll, the first step for the future uprising. So what's it saying?
So the people that are punished the most are the ones that are expected to take the first step into taking the change.
That's good. How should I write that up here? Let's say treaty. This is not exactly what you said, but I really like what you said. Okay. Treaty may force, this peace treaty that you're proposing on us may force an uprising. An uprising of who? What people?
The Germans.
The Germans. Let's fight back. Okay, so let's see what we have here. It's all about the treaty. It's all about losing the war. You put this treaty on us, which we have to accept blame for World War I, and now you're forcing an uprising. What could this factor be about? This is one of the main reasons for the Nazi rise to power. What could we title it?
Oh, like denial?
We're not there yet. It does have to do with propaganda, but what is that propaganda saying? Let's focus on that. Why? For what reason, though?
Revenge.
For what?
For being punished.
For what?
World War I, because of the Treaty of Versailles.
Okay, you said World War I. Okay, very good. Let's. I didn't give you this sheet yet, did I? Okay. What you all said, if we combine all of that, basically Germany's loss of the war and that treaty is one major factor that is going to push them into becoming powerful. Okay, I think we have time to do B, and that might be all we have time for. Please put A back. Take out B. Again, you have two photos. This first one copied is a little funny, so I'll put it up on the board. And then the second one, I really want you to pay close attention to, because it's going to offer a lot of interesting images that can really. All right, let's do 5 minutes. 4 minutes. Okay, here's B1 a little bit clearer.
to.
Even the bicycles. That's simple. I'm Syrian. You do know the symbol, right? You know the symbol of the person in Aspira.
Yeah.
Okay, you know what it's called.
He received a Purple Heart during that time. Purple heart is for what? You know? Soldiers get purple hearts for bravery. And later on, what forms the Nazi Party? Remember, the Nazi Party is a political party. We have Republican political party here, right? Trump is the nominee. We have Democrat political party. The Nazi Party is just a political party. Yes, of course, with more drastic ideals. So this is 2 years after Hitler has become the leader of Germany. When you see these symbols, for right now, think of them as a political party and not what we know them to represent. What's odd about this picture? What if this was Chicago in 2010, 2 years after Obama was elected? Is this something that we would see? No, why not?
Because he already won. He doesn't need the propaganda.
He already won. He perhaps doesn't need the propaganda, but what else could the military show? What symbol does that show? Strength. Okay, hang on a second, guys. So what I need back from you is if you can put B back in the folder, you keep your papers for 2 months, okay?